Planet X, Nibiru, megaquakes, nuclear war, martial law, new world order, FEMA camps, guillotines, aliens, UFOs, fallen angels, Anunnaki. The Earth will never be the same again. And at that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time. And at that time, your people shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book, and many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame. Lasting contempt.
Heavenly Father, we praise your holy name, Lord God, and we thank you, Father. We praise you, Father. We just thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Father God, we just lay our lives before you. We just give ourselves to you, Father. No matter what happens, no matter how things pan out, we just lay down our lives. We surrender all to you. Every single thing in our lives, we just lay it down before you, Father, because we know that the times that we are entering into, times like never before, Father, that these times are going to be harder than many of us can even imagine in our most horrible nightmares. And Father, we just know that you are going to protect us. We know that you are going to raise us up as that final harvest army, that spiritual army, Father, that touches people's lives in a time of darkness like the world has never seen. We pray in the name of Jesus, Father God, that you will make us all sharp arrows in your quiver, Father, that you will change us, mold us, and shape us, Father, in such a way that we are able to receive an outpouring of your Holy Spirit in such a manner, Father God, that we're able to change the lives of all of those around us within the realm of our influence, Father. We pray in Jesus' name that you will embolden us, that you will place rhema word upon our tongues, that those of us who have the ability that don't have the ability, that are shy, Father God, will be emboldened, that we can go out and touch people's lives even today. We pray in the name of Jesus, Father, that you will make us ready. We pray, Father God, if we don't have enough time in our busy lives, that you will help to adjust our lives. We claim it in the name of Jesus. Proverbs 21:1. The king's heart is in the hands of the Lord. Like the rivers of water, you turn it wherever you wish. And Father, we ask you in Jesus' name that you would adjust the tributaries of our lives, Father God, that you would adjust those who influence our lives, that you would adjust our lives in such a way, Father, that we're able and have a desire in our hearts to spend more time reading your word, to spend more time alone with you, Father, with the lights in some cases completely turned out, where we can focus our eyes on our Lord Jesus and just listen for that still small voice. We pray in the name of Jesus, Father, that you will become everything in our lives, to fill us with your love overflowing, that we are utterly obsessed with all things of the kingdom. Father, we ask you to empty our cups and fill us with only you, to touch us, Father God, in such a way that we know that we are at the ready, that we are, no matter what happens, no matter how things break loose in the days to come, Father, we're only 48 days away from the election, and we know things are not going to go as we perceive. All we can do is take the bits and pieces of the puzzles of the prophecies, Father, and lay them at your feet. We praise you, Father, for awakening us for a time such as this. No matter how things break loose, Father, we can see that wars and the rumors of wars and the pestilence and the famine and the things happening across the earth. And we know, Father, that you have blessed us abundantly in preparing us for a time such as this. We praise you, Father, and we pray in Jesus' name that you will use each of us to the greatest of our ability, Father God, by molding us and shaping us and drawing the dross off of the gold so that we can rise up as 24-karat gold and, Father, serve you like never before. Help us, Father, if there are things in our lives that we need to get rid of, if there are things that draw our attention away from the kingdom, things that we idolize above our Lord Jesus and spending time with them, Father, we pray that you will raise it up before us, make it clear before our eyes, bring it up, Father, so that it is right in our face, that we know beyond any shadow of a doubt that we need to make changes in our lives, Father God, to draw closer to you in every part of our walk. We praise your holy name for choosing us before the foundations of the earth, for we have not chosen you, but you chose us and appointed and ordained us that we should go and bear fruit, and that our fruit should remain, and that whatever we ask you, Father God, in the name of the Lord, our Lord Jesus Christ, shall be given unto us. John 15:16. We praise your holy name, and we thank you, Father. Make us ready for the final harvest. Place a spirit of boldness upon each of us to begin witnessing and planting seeds to people, Father, in the name of Jesus. We praise you, Father, for the opportunity that you have laid before us. We praise you, Father, for every chance that you give us to touch just one more person's life and lead them to the foot of the cross. And now to him who is able to keep us from stumbling and to present us faultless someday before the presence of your glory, Father God, with exceeding joy. And to you, Father, our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Brother Jason, are you there?
I'm here.
All right. Praise God. You might be on a speakerphone, but it might be okay. I'll let you know. Go ahead and try. I don't know, but go ahead and try. There was a little bit of an echo, so go ahead and I don't know. Say hello to everybody.
we'll do a sound check.
Nope, you sound good.
Okay?
Nope, you're sounding great. And at this point, I'm going to go ahead and just pretend like you're in a church, and I'm going to go ahead and step into the background and sit on my little preacher folding chair behind the podium. I'm going to hand the podium over to you. Jason is the author of Trumpet Blast Warning, which has a subtitle of An End Time Prophetic Wake-Up Call. And I understand, although I haven't heard all of your testimony, brother, I have had emails from folks, and they are saying it is powerful, and we are just blessed and excited to have you tonight. And on that note, I'm going to step back and hand you the mic and just let you tear into it. Praise Jesus.
Amen. Thank you so much. It's such a privilege to be with you tonight. So thank you very much for inviting me. So yeah, well, I mean, it all really started for me in 1991, October 1991. I was a young man. I was only 21 years old. And I was working away in my office. I got a call from the church that I was my family church. I was no longer going to that church, but my family church. The pastor telephoned me and he wanted to meet up with me. It was during the lunchtime. So I went up to the church. It was just an ordinary October lunchtime, nothing out of the ordinary. I walked into the double doors of the church and started to approach the stairways towards the sanctuary. And I can only describe as something like, well, it was the Holy Spirit came upon me with incredible power. And I was completely enveloped in what I can only call as electricity running across throughout my entire body. The intensity grew as I approached the sanctuary. And as I went into the church and I saw the pastor and his assistant on the stage area, by this point, I could hardly walk. I was staggering under this power, under this electricity. They looked at me and saw there was obviously something going on. By this point, as I approached the altar area, I just literally collapsed on my knees because I couldn't stand anymore under the weight of this. So they helped me onto a chair, took hold of my hands because they could see I was struggling, and it was at this point that the most incredible experience took place. In that, it was like a cinema screen opened up before me. It's difficult to describe, but what I saw at that point was like a rock. It was like a meteor hurtling through space. And it rushed through, what rushed past me. I was like standing in midair, in midspace, and I saw Europe. And I saw this rock plummet and hit Europe with this incredible impact. And when it did, I felt the power of it and the evil of it.
All right, praise God. I think the sound went dead on. I hope we didn't disconnect with you, Brother Jason. Okay, we just lost sound. I'm going to do a sound check. Sister Mary Lee, can you hear me okay? Uh-oh, doggone. He'll call back in. Boy, I was just getting good. I love that testimony already. I'm getting all freaked out, and I'm like, right on. Hallelujah. All right, let's watch. He'll call back in. He's got to. He has to. Unless the, transatlantic cable got bit in half by Leviathan. Oh, hallelujah. We live in some pretty dark times, folks. I would not be surprised if something really unbelievable like that happens to kick off the darkness that we're about to head into. All right, now I'm watching for him to call back in. Hopefully he realized if he was using Skype, Skype makes that funky sound when you get disconnected, like bloop. So he's probably, fiddle-futzing with his little the Skype dialer is kind of cumbersome for those of you who are not regular Skype users. It can be, you're like, oh, doggone it, where's my little Skype dialer? Hallelujah. Praise God. So anyway, we'll just go ahead and keep our eyes open for him to call back in, because did you hear that? Did you hear the start of that about a meteor or some kind of a rock hitting Europe? I'm excited to hear about that, because right now, folks, the two big ticket items of possible kickoffs for the end times include a possibility of a massive worldwide highly destructive meteor shower, that starts everything forward and in a cataclysmic poetic justice, if you will, and also the Pacific Northwest Cascadia Subduction Zone tsunami earthquake event, which would include Oregon and Washington State and Northern California in that. Praise God. So, again, I'm watching for Brother Jason to call back in. I'm going to go ahead and check my emails. Hold on just a second. I'm going to type it back to him. We lost you. Please, if you can, call back in. All right. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. Because otherwise I got to sing. I don't think you want me to sing. You know, T for two and two for T and T for – I could tell a joke. Hey, you know what? I could do that. All right, cool. So, you know, because, you know, the kids, we don't want to let the kids down. So while we're waiting for Brother Jason to call back in, I'm going to keep my eyes on the show console to look for his number to connect up, because I know, I just believe in my heart that he's going to be able to reconnect, unless they have some kind of freaky deaky, you know, like I said, some kind of internet problem over there. And folks, we're entering into a time when internet problems and collapses and riots and mayhem and bombs going off and filtering and system, as we're entering into a time when that's going to become, you know, part of doing any kind of radio show or electronic work for the Lord. Praise God. All right. Well, while we're waiting, hold on a second. Let me just double check and see if he's on the line again. Oh, come on. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Man, I really want to hear this testimony. All right. I'm watching again the emails. All right. All right. For the kids. For the kids. So we can just pass a little bit of time and get a smile on our face before we talk about the apocalyptic end of the world stuff. All right. Oh, no, wait. There he is. Hold on. Let me see if I can bring him on.
I'm here.
Oh, good. Yep. We can hear you. I was just gonna share with the audience a couple of. We usually have a part of the show where I lighten things up a little bit with some jokes for the kids. You know, the kids that listen. Okay. We have a lot of kids. But no, you dialed back in, so I don't have to bore everybody with the jokes. I'll just go ahead. I'll give them one just for fun. What's the dumbest animal in the jungle? What's the dumbest animal in a jungle? A polar bear. What do you think, kids? All right. Yeah, we got it. We got to tell the jokes for the kids, because the kids, you know, they tune in for that. Anyway, you were talking about a rock, or was it a meteor or something hitting over in Europe?
That's right. Yeah,
amen. Keep going with that, because I was just telling folks that we have a number of prophecies, dreams, and visions that we've been tracking over the years that indicate that possibly a very destructive meteor storm of some kind may kick off the really ugly part of the beginning of sorrows that Jesus warned us about in the Olivet Discourse. And so when you said that, I was just, wow, keep on going. Praise God. Go ahead.
Okay. Hallelujah. Yeah. So after this, I then staggered to my feet. You've got to imagine that I'm kind of in this kind of place where it's like I've got a cinema screen in front of my eyes. And I stagger to my feet, and suddenly I'm taken from this place to another place. I'm in the sand now. I'm kneeling down in the sand. And this tower, this giant golden tower, begins to grow up before me. I'm sort of like flying up with this tower as it's growing, and I'm watching this tower being built with gold. And as it reaches the top, it's very obvious that it's got the spirit of the Antichrist in it. Now, it was a shocking thing. It was very difficult, again, for me to sort of describe all of these things to you, but it was a very disturbing thing for me to experience and see this. Now, what was wonderful after that, I was then taken to this place where I saw the saints of God, and they were walking about the earth, and they were evangelizing in the end times. And they were completely filled with the love of Jesus. And so this was an incredible comfort to my soul. As you can imagine, I'd just seen this rock hit Europe with incredible evil. I'd then seen this golden tower that grew up. Now, at this point, I didn't fully understand what all of these things meant. I was just kind of being taken around these various places and seeing these things. Now, as this kind of subsided just a little, I left the church building. The pastor said to me, are you going to be okay? He could see I was obviously in a, I obviously experienced something quite intense. I left the church building, but at this point it was like I was kind of, it was like the veil between heaven and earth had been removed. And so it was like, it sounds very strange to say this, but I felt like I was having an experience where I was walking in on the new heaven and the new earth. It was like a future experience. And I saw the saints of God after the rapture of the church, and they were walking about. And they were like, it was quite strange. It was like they were almost gliding about rather than walking. I walked around the corner. Now, I'm outside. I'm in the town centre of my hometown. I look ahead of me, and I can see the sun setting, or the sun in the sky, but at the same time I could also see what looked to me like the New Jerusalem coming down out of the clouds. And I was in absolute awe of what was happening. So this continued, this whole experience continued. Now I'm cutting a long story short, but you can read about it in my book. I've got a couple of books out. One is called Beyond Earthly Realms, and it goes into more detail about this experience. But to cut a long story short, what happened next was I went back to my office. I said to my boss, who was a wonderful Christian, a wonderful servant of the Lord, he's now with the Lord. I said to him, look, I don't think I can't work this afternoon. I just didn't feel up to it after this experience. And he just took one look at me, and I didn't say anything to him. And he just said, well, you've just had a Damascus Road experience. That was confirmation to me that God was doing something. Well, at this point, I decided, well, I needed to get home. So I took the walk home, just a half an hour walk from the town. And when I actually arrived in my home, this is when this experience started to happen again, where this electricity started to envelop my entire body. Now, at this point, this was something that is incredibly precious to me, which I will never forget, because what actually happened was at this point, this electricity had completely enveloped me, and all of a sudden I could see Calvary's Hill. I could see the cross on which Jesus had died. And I had the vantage point as though I was looking out from the Lord's eyes, and I could see his arms stretched out on the cross of Calvary, and he died for my sin. And I was completely taken by this incredible encounter. And in fact, I was like, how on earth did I get to this place? And there was one moment I thought, because you've got to imagine, this experience for me was so real. I thought, is there any way I'm going to be able to get back from here? Well, that experience was so impressed upon my life. It's never gone away. Now, these experiences continued, and I say it was approximately 10 hours, and these experiences continued and continued until they left. But the days after that, I was in what I could say the presence of the Lord, and I was in this kind of sense of it was like the imminency of Christ's return. Now, that was back in 1991, so that was quite a few years back. So I think to myself, wow, where on earth are we on that clock right now? Now, this continued for a while. I was with the Lord. I was still seeing visions, not with the same strength in which I was seeing before, but I was just with the Lord. And then after that, what happened was suddenly it all just stopped. Well, for me, this was like a very interesting time for me, because I went from having all these, these visions and revelations to suddenly not experiencing anything. It was like suddenly God stopped talking to me. Well, from that point, I plummeted into a depression, because it was almost like a reverse culture shock from having all these incredible heavenly experiences, to suddenly, as it felt, like I was having no experiences at all. So This depression lasted for many weeks, actually, quite a few years. And I was in a state of like, Lord, where are you? Calling out to the Lord. Well, just to cut a long story short again, the time went on. I kind of put that vision to the side. I shelved it, didn't fully understand it, was confused about it in many ways. And because it had become such a sore point in my life, because I felt this sense of desperation as I felt the Lord had kind of wasn't speaking to me anymore. And then it was in 2009 that I was seeking the Lord with all my heart. I was so hungry for Jesus. And I would just like to say, like, to anyone out there that's listening, just be hungry for the Lord. Always be hungry for Jesus and keep calling out for him and just being in his presence. Well, this is what I was doing. And I say to some people, it's like the story of my life. I always feel like I need to know Jesus more. I want to know him more. And it's like it's not enough. And so I was in this place, it was back in 2009, funnily enough, it was October 2009, it was October 1991 when I had this experience, but now it's 2009, and I'm praying to the Lord. I'm saying, Lord, I need you, I'm so desperate for you, I feel like I'm in a desert place. And I turned to my wife this particular night, and I said, I just need to know the Lord more. But that night was an incredible night, in that I experienced something that I don't know whether it actually happened or whether it was a vivid dream. It was so real that I felt like I'd actually left the mattress of my bed. I felt my body go up into the sky. And while I was there, and again, I'm cutting a long story short because I know we're short of time. But I saw the Lord's hands coming out of these clouds. And as this happened, this cavity in my side opened, and the Lord put his hands into my side. And in the same way that I'd gone up, I traveled back down again. Now, at this point, what woke me up was the sensation of retouching my bed. So I woke up and I thought, what on earth has just happened? Well, I immediately fell back to sleep again, and I found myself in this white room. Again, this is a vivid vision dream, whatever you want to call it. I was in this white room and God the Father was standing there. I couldn't see his face, but I could just see his outline. And he just said to me, someone has come a great distance to see you. At this point, I saw coming around the corner from this corridor, this angel. I realized immediately he was an angel dressed in white. And he had the appearance of a Nigerian man in his, I would say, in his mid-50s. His face was shining black and his eyes were bright white. And he stood before me and I thought, oh my goodness, what on earth is going on? So I was like, what is happening at this point? I saw the angel then say to the Lord, what would you like me to say? So I thought, oh my goodness, I've got to remember everything that the angel has said. So the angel put his hand on my back, his hand on my back and his other hand on my heart. And he just said one word, and that one word was love. And then the dream immediately left. Well, it was a little bit later in the morning. I was still asleep, and the Holy Spirit woke me up and spoke to me. It sounded like an audible voice in my ear. Will you not tarry with me 1 hour? Now, you could imagine that at this point, after having this experience, I jumped straight out of bed, but I didn't. I fell back to sleep again. But immediately the Holy Spirit called out to me again and said, will you not tarry with me 1 hour? So I jumped out of bed repenting before the Lord for not having listened to him the first time. And I went downstairs and I had the most beautiful time of fellowship with the Lord Jesus. I mean, it was just absolutely amazing. Now, interestingly enough, what was happening at this time, from a political perspective, now you've got to understand at this point, I had no real political interest, no particular knowledge, passport, what maybe most people would have. Now, but what was actually happening in the European Union at that time, they were ratifying the Lisbon Treaty of Europe. And this was all kind of happening in the news. I knew nothing about the European Union at all. I'd done no research. I didn't know anything about it. But the Lord started to impress upon me the urgency of this situation, how we needed to, as a country, escape out of this union that I knew nothing about. And so, anyway, that morning, when my wife woke up, I explained to her this whole incredible vision where I'd been taken up into the heavens. I'd met this angel, and then I met the Lord and this angel. And she said to me, "So what did the Lord put into your side?" So I said, "Well, I don't know." She said, "Didn't you ask him?" And I said, "No, well, I didn't think to ask." And she said, "Well, you've got to seek the Lord, and you've got to ask him, what did the Lord put into your side?" So for a whole week, I set that time aside to seek the Lord and to ask him, what was it? What was that Lord that you put into my side? When I was in church that next morning, I was preparing, and I'm involved in helping the worship team get ready for that worship set and everything. And I was sitting there, and I just, all of a sudden, as the worship leader opened his mouth during the band practice to worship, I was suddenly taken in this place again where I saw the Lord putting these letters into my side, these enveloped letters. So I thought, wow, immediately I knew what they were. And they were warning letters to the Queen of England, the leader of the Conservative Party, and to the Prime Minister, who at the time was Gordon Brown. So when this happened, I had a fire in my belly, in my heart, and I was like, I've got to write these letters. And I felt the Holy Spirit saying, you've got to write these letters. They've got to be written quickly. This is urgent. And it was like there was a house on fire, and I needed to get people out of the house because it was burning down. So I needed to fulfill my duties for that day at the church. But as soon as I got home, I said, Lord, what am I going to write? And he just said to me, just put pen to paper and I will show you what to write. So in 3 days, I wrote these three letters to these high-level leaders. And basically, they were warning letters. They were very prophetic. They were just talking about how we needed to get out of the European Union before it was too late. I talked about how the Lord can see what is going on behind closed doors. He knows what secrets are going on and what politicians are talking about and the tricks that they are playing to deceive people. So these were the contents of these letters. But above all, it was like a warning that we had to get out, that Britain had to escape the European Union before it was too late. So I wrote these letters, I posted them, and I just knew in my spirit that God had done something. I didn't know what, but I just knew I'd obeyed the Lord, and that was that. So at this time, it was a little bit after this, the Lord then impressed upon me strongly to write a warning message for the world, which is in my book, Trumpet Blast Warning. And so really the whole mission that I feel that God has really given to me is primarily to preach Jesus Christ and to wake Christians up, you know, because I think about in Matthew 26 when the disciples slept at Jesus' most critical time. And so much I feel that in the church there are so many of us asleep. And I don't come here today as being one who says, hey, look, I'm awake, I'm this or I'm that, or I'm something special. I pray this prayer myself every day. Lord, don't let me be asleep today. Awaken my heart, awaken me. Don't let me be asleep in this critical hour. Because I really believe that that's what the Lord is calling the church to awaken in the hour in which we live. And, you know, Revelation 3:20 says Jesus is knocking on the door of our hearts. And he wasn't talking to unbelievers. He was talking to believers. You know, when he said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice, and I say, Lord, every day, it's like I can hear that knock on the door of my own heart. And I say, Lord, come in. Let's have a meal together. Let's sit together. Let's fellowship together. And I urge anyone who's listening to do that every day, because there's so many doors in our lives, so many doors that we can open. Things come knocking, you know, the movies, computer games, television, whatever it might be, sports, whatever it might be. These are things that we can open the door to, and we shut out the Lord. And I've just got such a sense of the imminency of Christ's return. But not only that, because some people say, well, I don't believe that Jesus is coming back. And I say, well, in some ways, it doesn't really matter what you think, because one way or the other, we're going to go and meet with the Lord, whether that's in our death or whether that's in the return of Christ. You know, and God forbid, but I could walk out tomorrow and walk under a bus, and then I'd be with the Lord right there. And that's the same for all of us. And I don't want to scare people by saying that, but it's just that sense of, well, life is short, and we don't know when it's going to come to an end. So let's always be with the Lord Jesus. Let's always have that sense of urgency to be with the Master, to be with the Lord. And so I talk a lot about the signs of that are leading up to the return of Christ. But something that I also say is, like, you know, let's not get too caught up with the signs and forget Jesus. You know, because I feel like, because the signs can be so interesting in and of themselves. But I say to a lot of people when I'm speaking, and I have speaking engagements, and I'm talking about this, and I say, you know, it would be as crazy as traveling towards Buckingham Palace or the White House, you know, and you're looking at all the signs and getting all excited about the signs, and then taking photographs of the signs, investigating the signs, and then coming away not having actually seen the actual thing that we were looking for. Forgot to take a photograph of the White House, forgot to visit Buckingham Palace or whatever it is that... and so I'm like, yeah, Lord, yeah, the signs are so important. You know, like the disciples said, what will be the signs of your coming in Matthew 24? And so they wanted to know the signs, because they wanted to know they wanted to know when Jesus was coming back. And so I talk a lot about the signs in my books, and just recently, because I do have a radio show myself on Eternal Radio here in the UK, and actually I've been talking about this show that was aired tonight, talking all about World War III and how we can see the imminency of something that is happening around the earth. You know, it's crazy what is happening. And again, I don't want to instill fear in people, because it's like we need to have that such a strength of relationship with the Lord that we know that when we are with him, we can walk through the valley of the shadow of death and we can fear absolutely no evil. You know, the scriptures say, don't they, even though war may come against me, of this will I be sure, you know, and we can be confident in the Lord. But, you know, I've been looking at, you know, there are so many flashpoints around the world that could ignite. You know, we look at the South China Sea and the drills that are going on there between China and Russia. And we see Japan and the US. And you think, my goodness me, you know, at any point, something could happen there. And then if you look at the Ukrainian crisis and the situation there, and how the EU and the US has aggravated that situation by toppling that leader in that country, and how, you know, Russia is just kind of, you know, poised. I think personally that Putin has offered incredible restraint in the situation that is unfolding on our world. And then, of course, you've got the Syrian crisis, which again is a volatile situation, where you've got Russia protecting Assad, wanting to keep Assad in power, and the US and NATO wanting to remove Assad. But again, you could have any situation there where an accident could occur that could easily ignite the situation into a global crisis. Then we've got Europe. I mean, my goodness me, Europe is just exploding at the moment with the migrant influx, which is an orchestrated attempt to bring down Europe, you know, divide and conquer, just to bring about absolute chaos. I mean, it's incredible, the open door policy that we have in Europe. And I thank the Lord, of course, you know, since I wrote those letters, we had the incredible results of Brexit. Which we've not got out yet, you know. But, you know, the result was the people said, yeah, we want to get out of this ailing this European Union. We want to remove ourselves. We want to stop the flood of migrants into the UK. But that situation in Europe, I mean, my goodness me, it's incredible. With the influx of the migrants, of course, we've got an influx of jihadists, you know, ISIS, Islamic terrorists coming into the country, you know, literally blowing up the country, raping the women and the children. I mean, it's an incredible situation. And of course, people say, you know, a lot of people don't realize that these situations are orchestrated from, you know, the global elite. And you think about, you know, in the United Nations, Peter Sutherland, I think his name is, you know, the head of the migrant representatives. You know, he talked about in 2012 of flooding Europe with migrants in order to undermine the homogeneity of the countries, you know, so that people don't have a sense of nationhood anymore. And of course, we're seeing that unfold every day, and we see the terrorist attacks. You know, governments don't have to, in Europe, produce false flags anymore. I mean, they just let these terrorists run riot and they can do what they want. And so we've got an incredible situation in Europe, and it's my prayer that the church rises up in power, awakens to the call. You know, we've got stories of civil war, imminent civil war in France. You know, Germany, you know, the government calling its people to stock up on food. You know, last year I posted a blog on my Trumpet Blast page about how it's time to stock up. Now, I know in America it's very popular for, more popular for Christians to think that way, but in the UK, people don't think like that. I had people laughing at me. Well, now the governments of Europe are now calling on our people to stock up, you know, to have enough food for 10 days, enough water for 4 days, to stock up on fuel, et cetera, because they see that there is a crisis coming, that there is trouble coming. And of course, Angela Merkel, she's now beginning to turn around on the whole idea of the migrant influx. She's beginning to regret it, but it's too late. You know, this is what has happened. This is the situation. So we're living in an incredible time at the moment. You know, we've got this populist movements growing up all over, you know, the UK with Brexit and the situation in America, you know, with everything that's happening with the elections. At the same time as all of the troubles that we're having, I think it's also a very exciting time for Christians around the world, and we need to step up to the plate and say, yes, Lord, I want to be part of this end time army. Don't let me be taken by the media manipulation, the propaganda that is being spewed out from our television screens. I mean, I don't know about you guys who are listening, but I can't believe the amount of, it's like propaganda, and the manipulation has been turned up so incredibly now. It's like you watch any of this stuff on the major news networks, and it's like, my goodness me, this is so biased, this is so untrue, this is so fabricated. You know, and so for me, I talk to Christians and I say, look, one of the things that we can do so that we're not deceived, because I believe that's one of the end time deceptions that is coming upon the world in these days, and through television, you know, that people are being deceived constantly by television, and we've got it on our smartphones now, wherever we go, computers, we're always connected to the mainstream media in one way or another, through Facebook, with the news feeds that pop up, telling us this, telling us that, telling us what we're supposed to believe. You know, it's so important that we get a perspective. And I tell people, you know, let's come away from the television. You know, personally, I've not watched television now for, it's almost 15 years. Me and my wife made a decision. We needed to come away and not watch television anymore, because we just felt that the manipulation, the propaganda, and more, you know, that was, you know, since 2009 when the Lord woke me up, because quite frankly, before then, I was quite asleep to everything, and I hadn't even understood the vision fully that I had received in 1991, where really the Lord was just showing me, look, I'm getting ready to return, the imminency of his return. You know, it was not too long ago that I was walking along the harbour in the town where I live, and I just had this sense of the Lord's presence coming about me. And I said to my wife, my goodness me, this feels like, you know, the parousal of Christ, that the sense of his coming. It was almost like, my goodness me, it was like so tangible. And I'm like, oh God, it's so... We've got to get ready. The church has got to get ready. His saints have got to be, we've got to be ready. I don't want to be stuck in a movie theater when the Lord returns. I don't want to be stuck playing a computer game when the Lord returns. I don't want to be stuck, not, you know, busying myself with things that are not of the Lord. I'm saying, Lord, just make me a radical believer in these end times, because, you know, friends, we have got radical people going about the earth. There's radical Islamists going about the earth doing their thing, but it's time for the church to rise up and be radical in their response to Christ, in their response and in their relationship to the Lord. And, you know, it's time for us to say, Lord, take my life, you know, let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. This is my prayer, you know, that we as a people rise up and say, Jesus, take us, let us run across the earth in these end times and preach the gospel while it's still day, while we've still got time, you know. And just coming back to that whole, you know, potential, you know, World War III and global nuclear war. Well, we can see just from Scripture, when we look at Scripture, how it infers quite strongly that the world will end in some kind of nuclear destruction. You know, we look at Zechariah, I think it's in 14, talks about, you know, people being dissolved while they stand on their feet, that their eyes being dissolved in their sockets. And, you know, when we look back in history and we can see Nagasaki and Hiroshima, this is what people experience. So we know these are the effects of nuclear wars. And of course, the Apostle John talks about in Revelation 9, the plagues of fire, smoke and sulfur. Revelation 18 talks about fire coming upon Babylon, which of course is the New World Order, the Antichrist being destroyed by fire. And of course, in those days, there was no weapons on earth when John had those visions that could destroy whole cities by fire. And now, of course, we have so many nuclear weapons, you know, 50 nuclear warheads in Turkey belonging to NATO. We've got nuclear weapons all over Europe. Italy now is looking like a US NATO base with its 10,000 military and civilians there. You know, nuclear weapons just pointing towards Russia. You know, it's an incredible situation that we're living in. You know, and then you've got the Apostle Peter that talks about the day of the Lord coming like a thief. You know, that unexpectedness, that suddenness. You know, when he talks about the heavens passing away with a great noise and the elements melting with fervent heat. You know, and he talks about what sort of lives should we live because these things are happening. You know, and that we should live lives of holy conduct and godliness as we look towards the Lord and we hasten his coming, you know. And then he talks about how we look towards a new heaven and a new earth. And I think that's so wonderful and so exciting, because it's like, wow, we're going to have a new body, there's going to be a new heaven, and there's going to be a new earth. You know, this earth is passing away. We don't have to be afraid, you know, because this isn't the final thing. You know, atheists, they think this is it. But for those who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, we know that what is coming is absolutely beyond what we could ever possibly imagine. And so I say to all Christians everywhere, let's make sure that we keep our lamps burning, that we have enough reserve in our lamps. You know, we haven't just got enough to light the way for a short while. You know, we want to have a reserve. We want to be completely full of the Lord. You know, and, you know, that's how I think it's Peter. In Peter talks about the coming of the day of the Lord, and he talks about how we look towards a new heaven and a new earth. And of course, that also mirrors what John says, the Apostle John says in Revelation 21, he talks about a new heaven and a new earth. And I think it's just a wonderful promise, but not only a promise for the future, because I always say to people, look, we can have that right now. We can have the Lord supporting us and being in our lives right now. We don't have to be running in fear and in terror, because that's what the global elite want to do. They want to bring such a sense of terror and fear that we don't know what to do, and all we want to do is turn to the government and look to them for help. And that's where they crack down more and more and control the citizens of the earth. But in God, we don't have to be afraid. We don't have to fall into that terror campaign and fall into fear and be subject to fear, to be subject to the enemy's lies, because that's one of his strategies in these end times, to bring about such a sense of fear. We're scared to go to London, we're scared to go to the major cities because we might get blown up. But at the end of the day, Jesus is our source. He is with us through everything. You know, and I think about Psalm 23 more than ever. I think about Psalm 23. You know, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. I think it's such a powerful scripture in light of the times in which we're living. I just feel that God wants his people to be prepared, you know, not only practically, because there's so many things we can do practically, but spiritually. But we can cut ourselves off from all of the lies, you know, that we can just begin to invest our time in worship and prayer and reading the scriptures and taking ourselves away and being aware that whenever we do watch the mainstream news, to be aware that there's a strategy underway, there's a propaganda campaign to bring us into the lies and the falsehood, which of course is the Antichrist spirit that pervades this age, and so that we can, as we are aware of these things, and as we keep ourselves connected to Jesus, we can, you know, we can be witnesses in these end times. We can be radicals, you know, we can be, you know, extremist Christians in the right sense of the word. You know, we can be totally extreme, totally sold out for Jesus Christ in these end times. So yeah, that's pretty much my heart, you know, for all believers everywhere to really, you know, Jesus is knocking, you know, and I don't know whether you can hear that right now, but I can hear it all the time. Jesus is knocking on the door of my heart. He says, let me in, let me come in, let's eat together, let's be together. Let's have a relationship together. Because, you know, it's not enough, is it, to go to church on a Sunday or on a Wednesday night or whenever the evening service is. Or it's not enough just to stick on a few worship songs in the car or to grab a scripture or a little soundbite on Facebook or whatever. It's not enough. God wants our all. And it's time for us to really give our all to Jesus Christ. And he will enable us to do that. He will empower us to do it as we call upon his name and say, Lord, let me open the door of my heart today. Let come into my life that I can know you more. I can know you more and show me wondrous things and open my eyes to the deception that is in this world and open my eyes primarily and ultimately to you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Praise God. So what do you think? Hold on a second. I'm just checking a sound feedback thing. All right, I think it's okay. So what do you think, after having that vision, what do you think it means today in the context of all that you've learned by being awakened to the creepy, weird mind control stuff that's going on in the media, the crescendo of darkness that is increasing across the world as we approach headfirst into World War III ultimately? I mean, when you look back upon that vision that you had, what is your takeaway? What do you think, what are your feelings are about it now as you look back into it? Do you feel in your heart there was a key meaning? I mean, I was taking some notes and I noticed, you know, you had mentioned some kind of a rock or meteor hitting Europe and then this golden tower rising up, which you believed was representative of the Antichrist. And then the saints rising up, essentially. And I'm like, wow, because that kind of summarizes, if you will, in a brief high-level summary, essentially what we have been tracking prophetically now for the last, 5 years. Now, of course, it didn't all come to us suddenly. I mean, we had to piece it together through prophecies, dreams, and visions over years of time, but... did you, when you saw this meteor hit in your vision, if you don't mind me asking, I'm curious, this, you clearly saw, am I correct by estimating that you clearly saw this meteor, if you will, hit in the, in, you know, Europe? Was it in the actual region of what we call today Europe, the continent of Europe? Was that, is that where it hit?
Yes, yes, it was Central Europe, yeah.
Okay, the reason why I call that out is because we know one of the things that this ministry slash program does is we study prophecies, dreams, and visions, and have, it's part of what we do for years and years and years. And it makes a narrative. It tells a story. And if you study it enough, obsessively, it becomes rather detailed and vivid. And it speaks about a timeline of events, not just a catalog of events, but an actual timeline, a chronology of events. And so we're always sensitive to things that people see in their visions when they retrofit into the prophetic narrative of apocalyptic events. And what's fascinating about what you were seeing is that we have, from the standpoint of a meteor, we've got the if you will, the meteor of all meteors, or the asteroid of all asteroids event, if you will, that that happens, that kicks off the sixth seal. There's a fellow out there by the name of the prophet Efren Rodriguez. Now, he is not the only one who saw it, which is good because we have confirmations from multiple disparate sources. But the most arguably the most well known is the prophet Efren Rodriguez from Puerto Rico. I think he's ultimately from Puerto Rico. And I'm not sure about that, but he's Hispanic, and he speaks in Spanish, and he's translated on his various YouTube videos. But anyway, he was given a vivid prophetic vision of a very, very large, if you will, meteor or asteroid smashing into the Earth, actually into the Atlantic Ocean, just off of the coast of Puerto Rico. In fact, his vision was so vivid that it included a number of secondary catastrophic effects that he was able to speak to in detail, which included evidently a 12-plus magnitude global earthquake, 3 days of darkness, which were associated with the hitting of the meteor against, you know, into the Earth, and a number of other things. And it's fascinating. When you put that into you make yourself a kind of like a chronology, and you say, well, okay, we know there's a super duper gigantic Mac Daddy meteor that's going to smash into the Earth. What can we estimate from that? Well, we can estimate that when that meteor does hit, it's going to cause a mega tsunami. That mega tsunami is going to hit at least the east coast of the United States, and probably the west coast of Africa. Probably it'll be so impactful that it will wash up north and hit even the UK and possibly even various places in Europe through the Med. We're talking about a mega tsunami. The magnitude 12 earthquake is going to be so powerful that it will ultimately shake the entire Earth. We know that the 8.3 magnitude earthquake in Chile about 2 to 3 years ago was so strong that it knocked the Earth off of its tilt, its axis. It was actually affected by a couple of degrees, and some of the airports had to recalibrate their aviation radars because of the impact of just that 8.3. So we're talking about a 12-plus magnitude quake. So when you measure the events associated with what we'll call the Efren Rodriguez mega meteor event, and you go back and you look at Jeremiah 51, where it says the abundance of the seas rise up over Babylon, there you have the tsunami hitting the United States. You look at the sixth seal in Revelation 6:12, where you have a great earthquake. I wish that the Greek actually used the word global. That would have been really nice if the Lord had used the word global instead of just great to describe the earthquake. But it stands to reason, since Jesus spoke about other earthquakes, you know, in diverse places, and the Bible in some very very specific places, calls out a great earthquake, which by differentiation, by the delta therein, in the that would imply that that great earthquake in Revelation 6:12, and it also in Ezekiel 38, is the same earthquake. That this is a Mac Daddy super duper extra large, you know, gigantamundus earthquake. Okay, then you've got, you know, the sun turns black as sackcloth of hair. So when you stitch it all together, you know, you have in Revelation 6:12, verse, I believe it's 14 or 15, it says, and every island and mountain was moved out of place. Well, there's your pole shift. Pretty doggone big pole shift. Okay? When you snap it all together, you come to the quick conclusion, I have, certainly, because I've been snapping lots of stuff together for many, many years, that this Efren Rodriguez gigantic meteor event is the kickoff to the sixth seal. Okay, and all the associated the scroll rolling, you know, the sky rolling up like a scroll, all that. It's all part of the side effects of this gigantic meteor. Now, the reason I bring that out is to juxtapose it side by side with what you were seeing, which is not that gigantic meteor. It's something else. It's a meteor-esque event, a rock, if you will, a meteor falling from the sky, hitting in Europe. Now, did you see cataclysmic output from that event? I mean, did you see destruction and mass cataclysmic output from that event when it occurred in your vision?
Yes, what I saw was as it hit Central Europe, I saw the ripple effects going out across Europe, which impacted the world. But I saw an incredible darkness that came with it. And I saw that the rock itself was evil, was wicked, but it had some kind of personality in it. And although I do believe that it could also mean a literal rock, a literal meteor hitting Europe, I also felt after that time that it was to do with the global empire, you know, the New World Order. And so I saw, and that's when I was then taken and I saw that golden tower grow up and saw the spirit of the Antichrist at the top. I saw that as part of the European Union. So I saw the rock as primarily something very wicked and something very evil that came upon the earth, but certainly it looks like a real rock in the vision.
Right.
In the vision, right, I had, it was an actual meteor that came and hit Central Europe.
Right. So I admit, I mean, I am not shy about coming straight out and admitting to anybody that I speak with in regard to such things that I'm a literalist. So while I do value the metaphorical understanding of various events that we see in prophecies, dreams, and visions, at the end of the day, I am the quintessential literalist. I always fall back to the literal. Not that there isn't spiritual meaning to other things that we see in events and the evil and all that kind of stuff. You know, I don't even rule out the possibility with some of the black slate technologies that exist with the influences of the fallen angels on the earth and the things that are going on at a very super ultra occult, dark, sick, twisted level, that they have the ability to guide rocks, if you will. You want to call it a rock, you want to call it a space rock, a meteor, whatever you want to call it. I believe that the forces of darkness have the ability through some of their power signs and laying wonders technologies to direct the course of space debris, if you will, a small asteroid or whatever. So it could very well be that it's both a spiritually dark controlled object or near Earth object that is controlled by the forces of darkness for the purpose of ushering in the Antichrist, causing chaos on a global level, being part of, if you will, that kickoff to the series of end times events. Because the reason why I'm going there is because there are a number of I did a very short 1 hour special radio show, which I forget what I called it, but something about the beginning of destruction or whatever. But I read a series of prophecies and dreams and visions that were from a wide range of folks, some highly vetted and some not as much, that seemed to be seeing, vision wise, something similar to what you saw. And when you analyze the chronology of the prophecies, dreams, and visions. See, I used to think that the church would be raptured off the earth before the rise of the Antichrist, but I found out later through the analysis of trustworthy prophets that is not the case, that the Antichrist actually will be visible to the bride of Jesus Christ, and she will know that he's the Antichrist, but most of the people of the earth won't. So the average, mediocre, foolish virgin type Christians, the little c Christians, will not know it's the Antichrist, but the bride who's anointed with the Holy Spirit will know spiritually. She will feel it. She will know it. And it, but the Antichrist will in fact rise up, whoever that may be. I know I have my votes. I know who I think it is. But anyway, at the end of the day, this will occur. This will occur prior to the rapture. Now, the reason I bring that up is because through the analysis of these prophecies, dreams, and visions over all of these years, it has become – I could sit here and I could give you quotations, and you could go and research every single quotation. I have it all posted on Tribulation Now's website for anybody who's interested in it. But I've come to the absolute conclusion that the rapture occurs in the midst of the chaos of the sixth seal. And I'm not getting, I could quote Pastor Sory Park and his being taken to heaven and how the Lord specifically showed him that the rapture occurred, in the seventh seal, which of course, from an earthly standpoint, would have to be in the midst of the sixth seal, because the seventh seal is a parenthetical, description of events, from the seal standpoint. So it would have to occur. We also know that, the day of the Lord, 2 Peter 3:10, the global thermonuclear war event occurs in the midst of the sixth seal for various reasons because of – so when we know that that's the case, and we also know that we're not appointed to wrath, the bride of Jesus Christ, 1 Thessalonians 5:9, it says, but you, brethren, are not of the darkness, that you are the night, that this day should overtake you as a thief. For we are not appointed to wrath. Why are we not appointed to, so if we're not appointed to wrath, when does wrath begin? Well, the Bible says so. The Bible says that the day of God's wrath begins in the Revelation chronology at Revelation chapter 6, verse 17. Okay, it says, and the day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand? So you've got the first seal, second seal, third seal, fourth seal, fifth seal, sixth seal, seventh seal. Then, after the sixth seal, the day of God's wrath begins at that point. Okay, then you go into the great tribulation, which is the trumpets, first trumpet, second trumpet, third trumpet. God numbered them for a reason. Shame on the preterists for taking them out of order. Okay, God put number one, number two, number three, number four. He put them in a numbers for a reason, to help us out, okay, and to keep people from twisting stuff and dorking it all up. All right, so praise Jesus, we at least know the bride is gone from the earth by no later than the very end of the sixth seal. Amen? Praise God. The Bible says so. We know that. All right. But then I look at what you saw, and then I look at the prophecies and dreams and visions that indicate that there could be meteor events of some kind, or maybe one massive meteor shower that's rather, catastrophic on a global level. One particular vision indicated several meteors hitting in the various parts of the United States and causing fires, massive fires, and disruptions in energy lines and oil lines and natural gas lines and all kinds of horrible stuff due to a series of meteors hitting the Earth. That there was some type of a space shuttle-like spacecraft, if you will, sort of like some of the vehicles that we have in our, you know, in the outer space right now around the Earth. I forget the one they call it, the X-19 or something like that, which is some kind of a new, you know, top secret kind of thing that they have up there. But anyway, that a shuttle was forced out of the sky, you know, the International Space Station, that kind of thing. It was forced out of the sky, when these meteors were hitting. So I wonder, because when I look at what you saw and the fact that right after that you saw the Golden Tower rising up, which was the Antichrist rising, and we know that the Antichrist rises before the sixth seal. We know that. So when you plug all this stuff in, it kind of looks to me like maybe – what you were seeing was perhaps one of those meteors hitting Europe that other people have seen hitting different parts of the world that could happen any day now. That a lot of people are very powerfully concerned, and YouTube videos flying all over the internet about people going, there's a meteor, there's an asteroid, it's the end of the world, it's going to happen any second now. There's all kinds of prophecy, dreams, and visions that are rising up, warning people about the end of September, possibly, or later, maybe, who knows, and they're all saying a meteor, but I'm wondering, could it be a meteor shower that we're in store for, and maybe that's what you saw, because that would be a fascinating, if you will, kickoff to the period of sorrows, which we haven't gone through yet, because Jesus told us, you know, you're going to see wars and rumors of wars and pestilence and famine, but the end is not yet, because this is the beginning of sorrows. Well, if that's the beginning of sorrows, which is where we are now, then guess what we have to go through? The sorrows period. We haven't even gotten to the third seal, the global financial collapse. We haven't even gotten to the fourth seal, which is World War III. We haven't even hit those yet. So the sixth seal's down the road a ways, right? So I'm thinking what the Lord showed you was a prelude cataclysmic event in your vision that kicks off the sorrows period, if you will, the seals period, the Gog and Magog period of the darkness that's about to hit the earth any time now. And I can tell by your plea to the listeners to get themselves right with Jesus, which is right on, that you sense that we're right on the edge of all of this breaking loose.
Mm. Amen. Yeah, amen.
I don't know.
Yeah, definitely.
Praise God.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, I agree that it could be a literal, you know, a literal application for this. I mean, you know, when you look at the book of Revelation, it's very literal, you know, it's not symbolic. And of course, the tower that I then saw next was literal, you know, because we just only have to look at the European Union and see the tower that they built there. You know, in Strasbourg. And so we can see that a lot of the vision that I saw was literal. So yes, yeah, totally, totally see what you're saying, yeah.
And the saints rising up is another humongous part of this whole dynamic as the darkness rolls across the earth as a tempest. See, a lot of people, the saints are going to rise up during the darkness. So the darker the darkness gets, the lighter the light is going to get. That one of the mistakes that a lot of theologians make is that they separate the two and they say, oh, well, the earth, they say all the bad stuff that's happening across the earth right now is going to go away and God's going to recover the earth and we're going to go into a period where there's going to be, you know, the manifest sons of God and they're going to rise up and there's going to be this huge global revival. Well, the mistake that they make is they separate the two. They say, well, the darkness is going to happen later and first the harvest is going to happen. I'm like, no, that is not how it happens. They both happen at the same time. Is that what you saw?
Totally. Yeah, absolutely. Totally. Yeah. It's simultaneous revival and also all of the evil coming out at the same time. So you've got this war on the earth. The saints rising up in power. Because I mean, this is something I've come across this a lot, where a lot of Christians say, hey, but there's going to be a global revival and we're going to live in some kind of a utopia. I'm like, no, that is not the way it's going to be. We're seeing it right now. You've still got people saying, I'm waiting for this revival where God's going to make everything, you know, everything good. And it's like, well, yeah, but can't you see that the evil is getting more evil? The darker is getting more darker. Well, at the same time, and that is my call, to the church. It's time for us to rise up. We rise up at the same time. And that's what I saw. I saw Holy Spirit-filled saints going across the earth at a time of incredible tribulation. So, yeah,
awesome.
Absolutely.
Totally. Awesome. Check this out. So Brother Jason, check this out. This will bless you powerfully. Go out and type on Google, of course, you know, after the show or whatever. Well, no, you need to get to bed because you're 6 hours ahead of us. It's like a wee hours of the morning for you. But praise Jesus. But make a note. Go out and search on the Tommy Hicks, TommyHicks. And let's I hope I'm spelling that right because I don't want to send people into a rabbit hole. I'm going to double check. Tommy Hicks vision. Yep. From 1961, the Tommy Hicks vision from 1961. And what's fascinating is when you read that, now I've read it, I think I'm on my fourth or fifth time of reading it. And I've noticed that prophecies, dreams, and visions, they're like the Bible. You know, lines upon lines, precepts upon precepts, here a little, there a little. You gotta, read them many, many times in order to glean additional information or whatever from them. You see new things every time you read them. And one of the things that jumped out at me in one of my readings of the Tommy Hicks vision of 1961 was that in the vision he sees – So I'm just going to cut to the chase because we're short on time, but that's all right. So essentially he sees this giant. He refers to it as a giant. But the giant is representative of the bride of Jesus Christ. What I noticed, and I did not notice it probably the first three times that I read it. It just didn't hit me. I read it. I saw it. I knew I was reading the words, but it didn't, I don't know, register in my heart, literally. I'm always looking for the literal meaning. I want to know, what does this mean? Applied Christianity 101. We can swim around in the swirly-whirly metaphors until we're blue in the face, but at the end of the day, if we can't apply it to our daily walk, what good does it do us? It's neat, it's cool, it's nifty. Oh, wow, angels and everything, but at the end, we really need to apply these things to our future and understand what does it mean to us so that we can act upon it according to God's will. Okay, and in Tommy Hicks's vision, this giant that is rising up, which is the bride, okay, the giant has problems at first. So in the first cycle of this giant rising up across the globe, the giant is getting up and rising up and rising up, and then it falls back down, and then it rises up again, and then it falls back down. So it's having trouble. It's going through tribulation. It's getting kicked around and punched and persecuted, and it's rising, but it's falling, and it's rising, and it's falling. And that I believe in the Tommy Hicks vision is essentially what part of what we're going to have to go through, which is the darkness, the struggle associated with being so dedicated to Jesus, so unshakable in our faith, so much like the Israelites were not like when they were thrown into the desert. We're going to be thrown into the desert. We're going to have to live off of the manna and the belief and the faith of the miracles of provision from our God, because we stand on His scripture, and we're going to have to fight our way through the darkness and proclaim the Lord Jesus Christ to the people that are lost. But then the cool part about the end of the Tommy Hicks vision, so we're going to have to go through darkness. We're going to have to go through struggles. We're going to have to go through our desert time, which is going to be hard and not easy. But then the cool part is at the very end, that giant, the bride, rose up and became unstoppable. Unstoppable, because she received an outpouring of glory from the heavens and supernatural power, and just rolled across the earth, and we just take in that final harvest with the glory light of Jesus all over us, Isaiah 60 verses 1 through 3, and oh my gosh, that's when it became that Tommy Hicks vision. Just that, when if you read it, I'm touching it's the tip of the iceberg when I'm sharing. When you read it, you'll cry, because you'll relate to it, and you will see the glory of it and how awesome it is, how we will literally be able to walk into crowds of people who want to kill us. and they won't be able to touch us because we will translate spiritually right through the crowds, and their weapons will have no effect on us. It'll be literally Psalms 91 in real time for us. It's a very exciting time that we have ahead of us.
Amen. Amen.
It's exciting. Praise God. Well, anyway, thank you so much. We're down to the last 7 minutes of the show. Would you share with everybody where they can go and get more information about your ministry and your book and everything, and then close with a prayer for us this evening?
Sure, yeah. My privilege. Well, you can go to www.trumpetsblastwarning.co.uk, and you can also go to www.endtimehour.co.uk. So that's www.trumpetblastwarning.co.uk and www.endtimehour.co.uk. Oh, Father God, I just want to thank you for your presence here with us today. Father God, I want to thank you for all the listeners. And I want to thank you, Father God, that you are there with us right now. And Father God, I want to thank you that you take away all fear in this hour. I thank you, Father, that you give us your peace. And Father, I want to pray for any listener out there that feels afraid, and maybe they've heard some things that are thinking, my goodness me, I don't think I can cope with this. Father, I pray that you would just put your spirit upon them right now, and that they would sense your presence and your peace in this hour. And Father God, I also pray, Lord Jesus, that you would enable us all to rise up in that wonderful time upon the earth during this time of tribulation and persecution, that we would be so resolute, that we would be so resolute and so empowered by you, Lord, just like those disciples back in the New Testament that were under so much persecution. Father God, that we would know that empowerment from your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father, that you promised to never leave us nor forsake us, and you said that you would be with us until the very end of the age. So, Father God, I thank you for the times in which we live. And I thank you, Father, that these might be scary times, but with you, Lord, they are exciting times. Hallelujah. We thank you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you so much, Brother Jason Carter, again, the author of the book Trumpet Blast Warning, an End Time Prophetic Wake-Up Call. What a powerful message, brother. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. God bless you all. Thank you all for joining us tonight. We will see you. Yeah, amen, brother. And folks, we will see you. Let's see. Today's Wednesday. I'll lose track of time sometime. Join us with the Friday night prayer vigil at 7 p.m. on the East Coast of the United States of Babylon the Great, where we give glory to Jesus and have communion together. And then join us for the Peterson Chronicle Saturday night, and then this Sunday as well. God bless you all. Thank you, Brother Jason. Take care, and we will see you. I will see you on the other side. So just look for the big guy with the Hawaiian shirt. I'll be chasing you down, giving you a big Jesus hug. Praise God. Thank you
bless
so much.
You. Bless you.
Come. I shall lift my obedient children to the clouds, for they shall see my glory.